So there's this episode of Star Trek The Next Generation called The Outcast. The Enterprise encounters an alien species, and it has no gender. Basically, the species rejects anything gender-conforming as a perversion. They're really into it. It's like their whole thing. And then Riker falls in love with one who secretly identifies as female and has sexual feelings for Riker. But she's captured by the authorities of her species, and they use a science fiction conversion therapy on her to brainwash her. Riker is sad. The end. This episode was made in 1992 and was intended as an allegory for the oppression of gay people. The episode received a lot of praise and condemnation, but not only criticism from anti-gay groups, like you'd expect, but condemnation from the gay community as well. Obviously, the episode is intended to preach tolerance, but it's also riddled with a few bugs in the system. For one, it conflates sexuality and gender identity, which are actually two different things. For another, for an episode about being gay, the romance is between a man and a woman. Jonathan Frakes has said he would have preferred the actor playing his love interest to be a man, but producer Rick Berman was not on board with this because Rick Berman sucks. Also, an explicit reference to sexual orientation was removed from the script. Also, even though the episode comes out against conversion therapy, which is a good thing they did that, it also suggests conversion therapy works, which it most certainly does not. For 1992, this was still considered progressive, and hey, you tried, but this leap into gay allegory didn't quite stick the landing. The point is that it's possible for something to be woke as f**k, especially for the time it was made, and also have noticeable problematic elements that tarnish what would otherwise be a solid piece of media. So, what does all this have to do with Big Trouble in Little China? Big Trouble in Little China is a 1986 film with a screenplay that was originally written by Gary Goldman and David Z. Weinstein as a Western before it was completely rewritten by W.D. Richter. You might know Richter as the screenwriter of the highly political remake of Invasion of the Body Snatchers and the director of The Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai Across the Eighth Dimension, a film that both is a sci-fi movie and a commentary on sci-fi itself. Big Trouble was directed by John I Have Things to Say Carpenter, so keep these creators in mind when we stumble through the socio-political commentary and genre-referencing narrative of Big Trouble in Little China. Depending on how you witnessed the movie, the protagonist of the film is either Jack Burton, due to him being the point of view character, fish out of water to whom the plot is explained, and owner of the most screen time, or Wang Chi, the character who has the most at stake from the beginning of the film and is significantly more competent than Jack at actually getting shit done. Jack is portrayed as a buffoon, a criticism of the muscle-headed and almost always white action hero of the time who stuck his nose in where it didn't belong and saved the locals with the power of being cast as the hero. Jack can't do anything right. He boasts about how great he is and never really backs it up. He is the least competent among his crew, and he has no idea what's going on at any given time. Jack is America, a naive but powerful entity that butts into internal matters in other cultures. Jack does the least amount of work and hogs all the credit. This is a common reading of the film, and based on both the screenwriter and the director, it's probably at least partially intentional. Jack is an oaf. He has one redeeming quality, his reflexes. This is planted early in the film and paid off toward the end when he catches a knife and kills David Lo Pan, the chief antagonist of the film. Immediately prior to this, Jack missed his first attempt and only managed to get the job done due to being able to call a cosmic mulligan. Afterward, he boasts about his reflex to his love interest, like Lego Batman.
First try!
So, okay, that's pretty self-reflective for 1986, right? The only white man in the movie pretends to be the hero, all the while the text of the film tells the audience that he most certainly is not, and that the people who actually know about their own culture know how to deal with their cultural specific problem. You tried. But it's not that simple. Okay, serious talk time. Orientalism is a way of depicting people of Asian origin that exaggerates and distorts differences of Asian people and culture as compared to that of Europe, the United States, and other white majority regions. It generally involves seeing Asian culture as exotic, primitive, and dangerous. There are other uses of this term in art and history, but the focus here is on the version of Orientalism that reduces people of the East to cultural signifiers and stereotypes for the consumption of audiences in the West. Now, the context of Big Trouble in Little China is different from a lot of these exotic and dangerous type films, especially considering Big Trouble cast actual actors of Asian heritage and not white men in yellowface like in so many other films. But the superficial cultural signifiers are still there. Way back in 1986, Sharon Ching of the Los Angeles Times wrote, "Chinese for Affirmative Action and other members of Asian media groups say it is unlikely that a white man would come into an Asian community to save the day. They also say that director John Carpenter's comedy Adventure, which had mediocre box office figures in its first 5 days, is racist and will encourage anti-Asian prejudices among young moviegoers." Henry Deer, at the time executive director of San Francisco's Chinese for Affirmative Action, said, "That's one thing we have to remember. It's a white script written for a white audience. The movie is still a white man's product." Critics, even white critics, were similarly unkind to this aspect of the film. Roger Ebert famously wrote of Big Trouble in Little China, "This movie is straight out of the era of Charlie Chan and Fu Manchu, with no apologies and all of the usual stereotypes. Big Trouble in Little China is just one more example of the way every American ethnic group has been fodder for Hollywood's mill." Some have argued that the film's presentation of the trivial and caricatured version of Asian culture from the perspective of Jack Burton might imply that this curated form of racism only exists for Americans who are fascinated by the hyperbolic and untrue version of Asian culture. But on the other hand, is that how it's going to come across to the audience? Are we giving intent too much credit here? Isn't it more significant how it's going to be witnessed and internalized by the audience? The perspective of, "maybe that's the point," feels defensive and uncritical, even dismissive of Orientalism in American films. Ethnic groups are not monolithic, and individuals within said groups can differ wildly in opinion, meaning that while some Asian Americans despised the film, some have defended it. Look, I love Big Trouble in Little China, it's one of my favorite childhood films, but it would be kind of arrogant of me to dismiss the actual concerns of the groups that are portrayed in the film by saying, "Oh, you just don't get it." That really sucks. Big Trouble in Little China is infinitely more self-aware of its tropes than the average action film, and because of this, a solid argument can be made that it's not as problematic as its contemporaries or similar movies that contain some of the same DNA. But that alone can't be enough to dismiss actual, equally legitimate criticism about its caricatured portrayal of Chinese culture. My point is that it can be both. Positive and negative elements in a movie are not mutually exclusive, even if those positive and negative elements are related. If Bram Stoker's Dracula can have a really good acting performance and a really bad acting performance, then Big Trouble in Little China can have a socially aware element and a socially oblivious element. The Outcast can be both a step forward in representation and also a step that stumbles and lands on its face. And Big Trouble in Little China can be both better than its analogs, in terms of representation, and also not nearly good enough. A movie with problematic elements doesn't necessarily need to be thrown in the garbage. And I'm not interested in canceling John Carpenter, but said problematic elements should be addressed so that further progress can be made. Ignoring something doesn't make it better. It never has. And I recognize that I'm not the best person to make this particular argument. My white ass does not know better than the people actually affected by this, but I hope that by being a decent ally and signal boosting this concern, I have done my small part. And if not, well, I tried. Hi everyone, I hope you liked the latest episode. Please click on the Patreon link if you want to support the show, and make sure to click subscribe and hit the notification bell so that you never miss an episode. I'll see you next week.